Okay, Mikołaj, so remember, relax and what feels natural, we're talking about free fall. Action.
Welcome to the Omni Calculator channel. Today we're gonna talk about the autumn.
No, not the autumn, free fall.
What are you talking about? Autumn is always free.
That's not the fall we're talking about. Free fall.
Fall? Like Roman Empire, fall because they
didn't make Roman Empire, just falling things. Free fall.
Falling like Elvis couldn't help.
No, I'll do this. Low.
Oh, that free fall! Got it!
Objects have been falling to the ground since there was a ground to fall into. But it wasn't until Aristotle that we started to think about it in an objective way. Instead of myths about thirsty gods, he wanted to understand the world in an objective way. So, in his investigations, he found that the world is made out of four basic elements: earth, water, air, and fire. Each element naturally tends to their original place. So for earth and water, that would be the surface of our planet, and for air and fire, that would be up in the heavens. So according to Aristotle, metal is made mostly out of earth, so it would fall faster than paper, which is made mostly out of fire. If both objects have the same composition, then the heavier would fall faster. Those hand-picked examples would make it seem like Aristotle was right, but we can easily disprove him by just crumpling this piece of paper and seeing how it falls. Or we can just take the book and the piece of paper, put them like this, and see how Aristotle was wrong. If you don't want to do any of these experiments yourself, you can always just use modern technology.
Aristotle claims survived almost 2,000 years, despite their obvious flaws. Italian scholar Galileo Galilei decided to bury them with facts. He tests Aristotle fairy tales by dropping metal balls from the top of the Leaning Tower of Pisa, or by using inclined plane, or by making a lot of thinking. No one really knows, historians still argue about that. However, it's not important. What really matters is that we repeat that experiment over and over again, and every experiment gives us the same results. Galileo was right. All the falling objects has the same acceleration. Galileo described the free fall, however, he didn't explain it. Why or how does it work? This was done by the big man himself, Isaac Newton.
And oh boy, did he explain it. According to a story that never happened, it was a mild concussion from an apple that made him realize that the reason it fell to the ground is the same that the moon and the stars don't. What he understood is that all objects with mass attract each other through a force he called gravity. In the case of the moon, it prevents it from running away from Earth, and in the case of the apple, just makes it fall down back to it. And just like that, as he was turning 23, he created a theory of everything with mass and everything that moves. And that's the reason most people consider Newton to be the greatest scientific mind in history.
And just at the moment we think that we understood what's going on thanks to Newton, Albert Einstein stole the show with his general theory of relativity. Basically, he proved that gravity is not a force but a curvature of space-time. Newton's equations are just cute approximations of a real physics. And everything is relative, so we don't really know if the ball is falling on the Earth or Earth is falling on the ball. So basically, we have to start explaining all over again. Not exactly. This is not how the science works. When the new laws of physics are accepted, it has to be proven in a field with experiments. When the new theory replaces the old one, it doesn't mean that old experiments were wrong. The reality doesn't change. So, the experiment shows that Newton was right, still shows it. However, thanks to the modern physics and general theory of relativity, we know more than Newton, and in some cases, his explanations are not enough. the only thing that Newton was wrong about is how universal his laws are. When I say it out loud, it seems a little bit too complicated. Let's put this in another way. For a second, think of science as a map of reality. And just like every other modern map, it has many different layers. For example, the map of the major roads may be imprecise, but very useful. So it happens in science. When we need to explain something simple, like a fall, we use imprecise, but very convenient to use Newton's layer. When we need to explain something more complicated, like how the mercury moves the way it does, or how the light bends around the black holes and stars, we need Einstein's layer. When you realize that, you can see that Einstein doesn't disapprove Newton's.
It expands on it, which is a great thing for us because that means we can use simple equations and vectors, aka arrows. We don't need to deal with weird metrics or multidimensional tensors for today. Here, the book is being pulled down by gravity and held up by my hand, which is effectively pushing it up. Once I remove my hand, the book falls down with an acceleration of 9.8 meters per square second. As the object moves down, it pushes the air out of the way. And action, reaction, equal and opposite, we get an upward force that slows the book down. While the force of gravity is proportional to the mass and constant throughout the fall, the drag is proportional to the cross-sectional area and increases with the square of the speed, so it increases during the fall. This is the reason our ball of paper falls faster than our piece of paper. It has a smaller cross-sectional area, a smaller footprint in the direction of motion. But what happens with the book and the piece of paper? They have basically the same cross-sectional area and the book falls faster, so it should have stronger drag, so it should fall slower. Except that's not really how things work, because the acceleration of gravity is the same for all objects, but the force is not. Heavier objects have a stronger pull downwards than smaller objects. For a given cross-sectional area, a heavier object might have such a strong pull that it renders the drag negligible, meaning it falls almost as if in vacuum. And this is the reason why parachutes are so light. If we would make very heavy parachutes, it doesn't matter how big the cross-sectional area is, it would just be negligible because the object is super heavy now. Which is why a parachute that works for a pen doesn't really work for me.
Yeah, for me neither. Because it didn't explain why book and paper can fall together when you put one on the top of another. Well, let's make one step back. A few seconds ago, Alvaro told you that mass increases the force of gravity. That's why book can fall quicker. When it does it, it basically punches a hole in the air, creating an area where there is a little less air and little less air resistance. In this area, paper could fall, well, pun intended, freely. Book is making all the hard stuff and paper is just a stowaway. Mystery solved.
Hell yeah! So drop a like in the video if you enjoy our journey of discovery.
Subscribe if you want to know where the map of science will lead us.
Drop us a comment with any new places and adventures for us to enjoy.
See you in the next video. And remember,
when science changes, it's not because it was wrong. We just learned something more. Bye.
Bye.